State Senator Julian Cyr is our guest this morning. Let's go on the record. He represents Cape Cod and the islands, an area that has just gone through an eventful summer season. What was learned in this time of COVID-19, and what can be done to ensure a bright future for this iconic place? It's time to go on the record.
From WCVB Channel 5, the inside word from Washington to Beacon Hill. Today's newsmakers are going on the record.
And welcome to OTR. I'm Ed Harding, along with News Center 5's political reporter, Sharman Sacchetti. With us this morning, our Janet Wu was off this week. And our guest this morning is Massachusetts State Senator Julian Cyr. He represents the Cape and the Islands, first elected in 2016. He's the youngest member of the Senate and the Assistant Majority Whip, an advocate for LGBTQ rights and mental health access. He's a graduate of New York University. It's great to have you with us this morning.
Good morning.
To see you.
Happy October.
To be with you.
Happy October. It's still a gorgeous time on the Cape.
Amen.
Well, we had quite a summer on the Cape for sure. Let's start with the COVID-19 spike in Provincetown. What could have been a public health disaster, it turned out it was not. So why was that, and what do you think we learned from that?
So what's remarkable about this Provincetown cluster, right? We had over 1,143 confirmed cases, which from a public health perspective, actually, we probably had a lot more cases than that. Right. And of all of those cases, we only had 8 hospitalizations of all of those cases, which really shows that the vaccines work and are really effective. Why did this happen in Provincetown, and why did we pick up on this so soon? It's really because we've got a community that is really used to healthcare-seeking behavior, particularly in the LGBTQ community. This isn't our first pandemic. And so we were able to pick up through our community health center, you know, very early on after that July 4th holiday, just a few days later, an increase in cases, 1, 2 cases, 7 cases. We were able to respond. We brought the full resources of the state. And I think that enabled us to get a real handle on this. I really do believe that as we've learned more about COVID-19 in the context of vaccinated people and breakthrough cases, that probably what was going on in Provincetown was happening elsewhere, elsewhere on Cape Cod and the islands, elsewhere in Massachusetts, elsewhere in the country. We just were able to pick up on it so soon because we had such a fast response and we were testing.
And to be fair, that was around July 4th when it was, I know it was a long time ago now, but when it was kind of cold and rainy and people went indoors.
Yeah.
And that, you think that made a difference?
I think that contributed a big part, right? Typically, it's a July 4th holiday. You want to be outside.
Right.
And I just remember, places were packed. People were spending time inside. And certainly there was a lot of hardship, I think, particularly economically, right? Because the season, the rug was sort of pulled out from under us in the season, at least on the Outer Cape in Provincetown. But really the public health response was exemplary. And, now we have very low rates, of COVID-19 in Provincetown. And really across Cape Cod, I think we've proven that we're a region that can welcome people during a pandemic, and we can do so safely.
So you've segued us into the next question perfectly. So let's talk about the Cape economy. Workers, it's almost like the confluence of many things. First of all, you've got the pandemic, right? That's in place and that's been there. Second of all, you got workers in short supply all summer long. Right now, some restaurants have shut down on certain days because they don't have enough staff. It's a simple question. And I'm sure if it could be, it would be done. But can anything be done to fix this?
So the worker shortage on Cape Cod and on the islands is all about one thing, and it's about housing. We simply don't have enough housing for our workforce.
That's not a new problem, right?
No, this is an old problem.
Right.
I mean, this has been a 20-year problem. I remember reading about this. I was one of these middle school kids, right, who would be reading the local paper, and we had a housing crisis, in the 2000s. And what's happened, right, is that we've not kept up with housing production. These are local decisions, right? I can't fix this problem on Beacon Hill. If you're talking about zoning, you're talking about housing production, you're talking about building, each of our towns has that decision-making power. And we've just not kept up with housing production. We've seen a 24% increase in the cost of single-family homes in Barnstable County. 24% in a year. It's completely unsustainable. And really what you see, right, is COVID-19 has just sort of put what's been a crisis sort of over the edge. And that's what happened this summer. And I think we're going to continue to see that. And the tough thing, particularly given the persistent NIMBYism in some communities and the fact that these projects just take a whole long time, is it's not something you can fix really easily.
Well, so therefore, you sound like this is a problem that's going to reemerge next Memorial Day. It's not going away.
Absolutely. I think as a region, we're really trying to pull together decision makers and thought leaders to really do the work of convincing, town by town, town meeting by town meeting, that we need to get so serious, yes, about building affordable housing, but workforce housing. The key to that on Cape Cod is wastewater. We've done our part in Beacon Hill. We created a Cape and Islands Water Production Fund that's going to provide over $1 billion for wastewater infrastructure on Cape Cod over the life of the fund over the next several decades. Now we really need the towns to act and get really aggressive here, because if we don't fix this right, Cape Codders and Islanders, particularly, you know, the islands, the Outer Cape, but the whole region, right? People of my generation, we're just not able to make it. We're not able to afford the housing.
Well, it's a given that the Cape Cod bridges will be replaced. So this is a federal project. How much input will the state have on this?
So I actually touched base with the congressional delegation earlier this week. They feel very confident that we're going to get federal resources. The feds basically are responsible for sort of concrete to concrete, right, the bridge portion. Mm-hmm. At the state level, there's all this work that has to be done to connect the new bridges. We already authorized over $600 million, working with Senator Sue Moran, my colleague, to get that in place. So once that funding comes, once the federal government starts working on those new bridges, we will then have the resources in place to not only replace the bridges, but really improve the pretty awful traffic situation that we've got over the canal.
It's pretty awful.
Oh, yeah, really, right?
You're confident in the process, though?
I feel very confident. I spoke to the delegation, you know, recently about this, and I think that, you know, there's a number of streams, whether it's through the infrastructure bill. There's already some monies that the state has available as well. So I feel good about the bridges project. Honestly, it's moving faster than I thought it would.
Yeah, but it is for everyone. I think even if you don't live in the Cape, it's a shared misery because we all go through it.
Unless you
take the ferry.
Take the ferry.
I want to put two words on the table.
Yes.
Beach access. Because of laws that are set down long before we were here, back in the colonial era, Massachusetts has the most restrictive beach access laws in the country when it comes to private property. So explain to us how you would like to change that by just changing one word. What's the word?
So the word is recreation. And why are we looking at one word?
Right.
Because the colonial ordinances basically tried to establish the public would have access to use this sort of intertidal area for fishing, fowling, and navigation, because 400 years ago, what did you do on the beach? Well, you went hunting, you went fishing.
You survived off
it. You know,
right.
You survived it. Right. You didn't necessarily go to the beach.
Right.
In 1866, we enshrined that into Chapter 91. Again, beach use was sort of very different, you know, 150, almost 200 years ago. And so by including the word recreation, we think, and I'm doing this with my colleague Dylan Fernandez, that we can actually realize the intent of the colonial ordinance, which was always about public access. There's a strong tradition dating back to English law, Roman law, around public access here. Massachusetts has the most restrictive beach access laws in the country. This just isn't who we are as a commonwealth. So we're trying to fix this here. We'll see what kind of traction we can get. It's certainly been a tough issue before, but really I think, you know, we all should have access to this pretty special resource. And with climate change, the beach, what is actually the beach, is shifting.
Yeah.
And so we're going to be running into all sorts of issues with rising seas. So let's get ahead of this and just avoid a lot of this needless prohibition on beach access.